not an hour of another day, but Lord, I need you right away. If I never needed you before to show up and restore all of the faith that I left slip while I was yet searching the world for more, the truest friend I have indeed.
Good evening, everyone. How are you doing? Good to see each of you here on tonight on our Teaching Tuesdays. I see you, Sister Curry. I see you, Sister Antoinette and Brother Sterling. And Sister Carrie is now joining us, and others are coming online. Good to see you. Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Great, great. Glad to have you tonight as we proceed forward, with our Teaching Tuesdays. I'm here live at the sanctuary of the Cornerstone Missionary Baptist Church of Oakland, California, where the Reverend Dr. Lester L. Cannon Sr. Has been our pastor now for 42 tremendous years. Amen. Amen. And we are actually in the midst of our pastoral anniversary and our pastoral revival, where we are celebrating his 42 years, he and Sister Cannon's 42 years of pastoring here. And we'd like for you to join us. We'd love for you to join us for the next, three, four Sundays that we have in the month of May. As we get started here tonight, we want to first go ahead and we want to look at our sick and shut in list. And let me go ahead and pull it up, if I may. And our sick and shut in list here, these are the individuals who are personally right now just going through a storm, going through a battle right now. They are sick and shut in, and we believe in medical miracles, and we believe that God can move things around and that he can change things and change circumstances. And so let me put these up for us to see. And I'd love for you, Sister Antoinette, if you would start us off on the sick and shut in. And then we're glad to see Sister Margaret Trotter on tonight. God bless you, Sister Trotter.
Amen.
Glad to have you with us. And we're always glad we're praying. You'll see here on the list, we're praying for Brother Carlton. And then I'm going to ask Janetta, if you'll just be ready, waiting in the wings. And then Deacon Larry Van, if you'll be ready and waiting in the wings as well. So on tonight, on our sick and shut in, we're praying for you, Mother Gussie Freeman, Mother Virginia Chestnut, and our beloved Brother Carlton Trotter. We're praying for him and Deacon Matthew Worthington and Sister Catherine McDaniel and Sister Mary Turner. We're lifting you up. We love you all. Amen. Deacon Robert Watson, Sister Mildred Traylor, Brother Milton Owens, and we're certainly praying for Brother Lionel Richardson, who is on hospice care and has been there for some time, but the Lord has defied what the doctors have said. And then Sister Charlene Richardson has been hospitalized. We're praying for her. Praise God. We are praying for you, Sister Roxanne Chambers, and we saw her on Sunday. Amen. And so, Sister Antoinette, if you'll go ahead, and we're going to scroll the names again of those individuals who are on the sick and shut-in list, and those of you who are at home and on other platforms, if you would just pray for the names as you see them on the screen while Antoinette, Sister Antoinette Harris is praying for them as well.
Father God, I come before you again today, first acknowledging the fact that you are the most holy and wise God, just saluting and uplifting, praising your name for who you are, for all that you've done. Just grateful, Father God, for a relationship with you through Jesus Christ. And I ask, Father, for cleansing of my sins, that not only would you hear this prayer, but also that I'd have a connection with you through your son, Jesus Christ. And I thank you for an opportunity to pray for those who are on our sick and shut-in list. I pray for those, Father God, who are new to the list, as well as those who've been on the list for a while. I pray, Father God, that you would continue to grant healing within their bodies. I pray, Father God, that you would continue to speak to the doctors, the nurses, all those who are attending to their care, and that you would provide them with insight, with wisdom, in order for those who are on our list that they might be well. I pray, Father God, for grace, because there are times, Father, when people want to just give up because they're tired of being sick. And so I do pray, Father God, that you extend your grace and your mercy, that you would allow them to be comforted, that you would give them strength, that you would give them all that they need, Father God, to be sustained. I pray for those who are not even aware of their presence in this world. I pray for those, Father God, who have been lingering and the doctors have given up hope. I pray for those, Father God, who are going through various challenges with new illnesses, new diagnoses. And I just pray, Father God, that their spirits would be uplifted. But I also pray, Father, for their family members, that they would not be discouraged, that they would not grow weary in well-doing. I pray, Father God, for their emotional well-being, and that you would strengthen them and allow them to go forward from day to day. Thank you for the presence of Sister Margaret, whose husband, Carlton, is on our prayer list and has been for a while. I thank you, Father God, for her presence on tonight, and I pray that she would be blessed and encouraged. I pray, Father God, that your word would be a source of strength, that our prayers would be, knowing that we are praying, would be a source of comfort, and that you would do miraculous things in the lives of those who are listed. And I also pray for our pastor, Father, that Pastor Cannon, that you would continue to strengthen and heal his body. I pray that you would allow him to know that you are ever with him, and allow him to know, Father God, that while the doctors are attending to him, while the doctors are figuring things out, you already know what his results will be. And I'm just grateful, Father God, for the fact that you hear and answer our prayers. And we've seen names roll off of this prayer list because you have provided healing and deliverance. And I pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you so much, Sister Antoinette Harris. And we're going to now call off the names of those who are on the special prayer request under special prayer. And Sister Janetta, if you will unmute yourself, please, and just be prepared after I call off all of the names. And of course, topping the list on the special prayer request is our pastor, the pastoral family, Sister Cannon, Tammy, Lester Jr. We're praying for Brother Tony Jones, the Cornerstone Church families, Brother Michael and Sister Charlotte Scott, Cornerstone Christian Academy, that is the parents, the students, and the staff. We're lifting up Myla Walford, Linda Hooker, Sterling Hollins, who's on with us tonight, Margaret Davis, Iris Barnett, and Sister Alice Earl and family, Brother Horace and Sister Loretta Hill, Sister Tanisha Watts, Connie Levi, Brother Teddy, and Sister Yolanda Sinclair, Sister Yvonne, and Sister Yolanda John, Sister Mary Turner. We're praying for Sister Sonia Brown, Brandon Gaddy, Sister Faye Simpson of Bakersfield, and her son, Brother Ray Cockerharm, Sister Berna Bowie, Deacon Calhoun, the Carpenter and the Martinez families, Brother Philip Cooper, Brother Nathaniel Patrick has had two sisters to pass away just within the last week or so. And so we're certainly lifting him up. Sister Eula Tyson as well. Sister Ebony Cross, Sister Georgie Baker, new member here at the church. And she's excited, but she had to have surgery. Brother Fred Allen, Brother James Barron, Mother Gladys Jenkins was here, our oldest member, 95 years old, Minister Randy Leonard as well. And so these are the names of those who have requested special prayer, if you will. And so we want to ask if Sister Janetta will go ahead and just do a general prayer for them.
Amen. Heavenly Father, I come before you this evening, Lord, just want to say, Lord God, how great you are, how magnificent you are. We come before you humbly, submitting ourselves and just coming before you with praise, adoration, and lifting up your name. First of all, just glorifying you for who you are and for all your mighty works. Lord, I come before you thinking how great and how magnificent you are. And I come before you lifting up those who are on our sick and shut-in list, Lord. We know that you are a God who listens to us all. You hear our prayers, our concerns, our worries. And so, Lord, I'm coming before you asking that you would please comfort and strengthen the many names that are on this list, Lord. We lift them up to you. Your word says you hear our cry and you attend unto our prayer. And when our heart is overwhelmed, Lord, you lead us to the rock that is higher than us. And so we come before you, coming before you with humbly submitting ourselves, lifting these prayers up to you, lifting these names on here. We specifically want to pray for our pastor and his surgery that he recently had. Lord, we just pray for healing. We lift him up. We pray for his strength. We pray for encouragement for him. We lift up Sister Cannon as she attends to him and ministers and takes care of her husband, Lord. I just pray that you comfort her, strengthen her and their entire family. And then there are other names, Brother Tony Jones, all the names that have been read off, Lord. You know each and every one of them, and you know the names that are not on this list as well. But we know that we serve a glorious God who daily hears our prayers and our burdens, and he also gives us strength. He is the rock, the mountain that is higher than us, and we come to him humbly submitting ourselves. Lord, I ask for your strength. I ask that you would comfort those who are struggling. Sister Alice Earle, as she goes through the second round of cancer, Lord, I pray that you strengthen her and comfort her. And Lord, I pray for her daughter as she attends to her mother. Lord, I pray that you just comfort the entire family. And then, Lord, we just want to thank you for the many things, the many acts that you've done for it. You are just a glorious God, and you're so worthy of praise. You are the one that we can come to. We don't have to be anxious for anything, but we take everything to you in prayer, knowing that you hear our cries, Lord, and we know that you answer. For you are a good God, you're a merciful God, you're an everlasting God, and as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is your love for us and for those of us who love you, Lord. So I just continue to lift up our church family. I lift up everyone that's on this prayer line. I lift up Sister Bowie. I pray for her and her illness. Sister Sonia Brown, as she's dealing with the loss of a home. But Lord, any materialistic thing, we know that you can give it to us again. So she just needs to just remain faithful. Just keep loving you. Keep trusting in you. Keep listening to your voice and to hold fast unto you. For you are the Lord. And if we have you in our lives, we have everything that we need, everything that we desire. Lord, you are a good God. You are a refuge in time, a refuge in times of trouble. You care for those who trust in you, and we trust in you so mightily, Lord. And we know that we can just humbly submit ourselves. So I pray for everyone on this list. Sister Ebony Cross, Sister Georgia Baker, Fred Allen, Lord, all of the names that are listed. Have mercy upon us all. Please give them the strength, be their shield, be their comforter as they go through whatever trials that are before them. And then we just pray this in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you so much, Sister Johnetta. Deacon Larry Van, as I call off the names, or after I call off the names of those families that are in bereavement, would you please unmute yourself and go ahead and pray for Deacon Matthew Worthington and Sister Sabrina Calhoun, Sister Gwen Mosley, Sister Anna Sampson, the Woolrich family, Sister Joyce Williams of Bakersfield, Gwen and Jency Bryant, and of course yourself is on this list as well, Deacon Van, and Sister Mildred Traylor, Damone Jordan, Deacon Michael Woodard, Deacon Early Barnes, Brother James Cherry, Deacon Fred Starks as well, because we know that the effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much.
continuing in prayer, Lord, we just come giving you the praise, the honor, and the glory for who you are and how powerful you are in all your many ways, Lord. And we come first off asking for forgiveness of our sins and just wanting to hide your word in our heart that we might not sin against thee. Just thanking you for all that you do and all you give. Lord, we come now on behalf of these families that are in bereavement, Lord. And we're just asking that you continue to put your loving arms around each and every one of these families that has lost a loved one. And that you would just keep them lifted up, Lord, and that they would just think of good memories of their loved ones and that you would just hold them up during this time. We don't know what each one is going through, but we know you do. And Lord, you are our comforter and we get power from you. And when we're down and we feel like we can't go any further, Lord, we can call on you and you can lift us up. These families are in bereavement and along with my family. And we just don't know what each other is going through, Lord, but we know that you know, and you're a healer, you're a protector, and you're a provider. And we ask it now that you be amongst these families, Lord. We just ask it now that you would lift us up. It can be dark and lonely in this place when we lose a loved one. Just don't know how it affects each and every one of us, Lord. But we know you do, and you have the power to heal us and make things right with us, and that we can look to the future. We can do all that through you. We ask it now, each and every family member, looking on the Woodard family, looking on the Worthington family. Lord, you know all the names, looking on Gwen Bryan, Matthew Worthington, Sabrina Calhoun, Gwen Mosley, the Sampson family. Lord, we just ask that you just give comfort to all of them that are in bereavement right now. We just ask it now in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank each of you for your fervent, effectual prayers for our sick and shut in, and for those who are who have special prayer requests. And we thank you for praying for those who are in bereavement right now. We're glad to have you, Sister Trotter. Sister Margaret Trotter, if you're able to, can you just unmute right quick and just say hi?
Hello, everyone.
Oh, right.
Hi, Sister Margaret.
Hello. Hello, Sister Margaret.
Hey,
hi.
So I guess I did it right.
You did.
Good. We're just glad to hear your voice, and we are certainly in prayer, as you can see, for Brother Trotter, and we love you and your family.
And thank you.
Glad that you're a part of this here, and Pastor will be excited to know that you joined us on tonight. So I just wanted to just say that right quick. And we're into this exciting study that we have on the adventure, if you will, of discipling others. We've been walking through this thing, taking our time through it, if you will. Sister Antoinette, why don't you go right on ahead and take us further?
Okay, well, before we launch into our lesson, and we're almost done with session number 4, Mentoring Life to Life. But before we do that, let me see if I can get Sister Kathy Wilson to unmute and give just a couple of minutes about your devotion or the progress of your spiritual life.
Good afternoon.
Hey, Kathy.
Hi. Well, towards my progress, what I have been noticing about my devotion, that I'm having more of a desire to, well, I don't even have to set my alarm clock anymore at 4:45. The Lord has been waking me up and making me feel good about getting up. And I'm finding out a lot about myself, as I thought I was having things under control on personality, would you say? But then I, as I read God's word and stuff and see how it tells me to examine myself on the things that I do or how I react and everything, I find more and more where I am trying to dig deeper into God's word for God can use me the way he wants to use me and to be able to express myself in a way that only that I know that it's not me, but it's Christ that's using me.
Amen.
So I'm thankful for the book. I'm thankful for Sunday's lesson. And even with this pandemic, I'm kind of thankful because it had allowed me to stand still and study God's word. So praying that I would grow deeper in his word, that I would be able to let my life shine at the job that I live or work at in order for them too to have a desire to ask about my joy and my peace.
Amen.
Amen.
All right. Thank you, Sister Kathy, so much for sharing. We want to make sure that we take time each week to have someone share a little bit about their devotion or their spiritual progress. That's what discipleship is all about. How do we incorporate the word of God and the communion of prayer, praying with God to help us to grow spiritually. And then we in turn are able to help others to grow. So we're in module number one, understanding the blueprint. And we're on session number four, the Bible study for session number four. And the Bible study is entitled Ministering Life to Life. We've walked through several aspects of this study. Mm-hmm. A large part of it was life-to-life case study, where we examined the relationship between Paul and Timothy. We've also focused on, the fact that life-to-life ministry gives focused attention, either one-on-one in a group or a large group or even a small group setting. And we are coming close to the end of coaching and life to life. And we spent the last couple of weeks looking at various scriptures that focused on the superlative qualities, the superlative a coach that has very high qualities, superior qualities, excellent qualities. And we reviewed, I believe it's seven scriptures. Yep. And so what we would like to do this evening, we're on 3B on page 74 of our study, where it asks us to summarize. We've looked at the scriptures, we've broken them down, and now we're being asked to summarize what makes an effective spiritual coach. And so our ask last week was for you to go through those seven scriptures, highlight key words and or phrases that would help you to develop a definition for an effective spiritual coach. And that's where we'd like to start. In one of my leadership meetings today, one of the things that we talked about was important to include everyone in the conversation. So unless we've gotten some information from you via chat or some other forum that you do not want to participate in tonight's class verbally, we're going to take the time to call on folks to provide answers to these questions. So again, it's summarizing what you think makes an effective spiritual coach. And so I see Sister Diane looking up at me and getting ready to smile. There she goes. Sister Diane, would you mind unmuting? And then we would like to call on, I'm just going to randomly call on Sister Betty, Sister Gail. I see Sister Gail. So I'm not sure if it's just Sister Gail or if it's Sister Gail and Brother Gene. But if you, the three of you would unmute and provide us with some feedback for 3A.
Okay.
Thank you.
3A. Here we go.
I'm sorry, 3B. 3B, where you're 3B. Summarizing.
Mm-hmm. 3B, summarizing, got it.
Yes, I'm sorry.
Okay, so I kind of looked at each area and the emphasis in each area. So I had stated that, hold on. An effective spiritual coach first is one who sets a goal with whom they're coaching. And then I got that from Deuteronomy 3:28, where they talk about commissioning or charging their disciplee.
Right.
So you've got a goal where you know you want to go.
Amen.
Second, that this person has strong faith in God. That was from 1 Samuel 14, 6 through 7.
Okay.
Third, an effective spiritual coach is a preparer. He prepares the person he's coaching for future perils and struggles. And that's in Acts 20, 28 and 31.
Okay.
And then I went, and some of them overlap. This person is an encourager and a peacemaker. Mm-hmm. And that's found in Ephesians 4 through 11, 13.
Great.
This effective spiritual coach respects those who work hard amongst them mm-hmm. and over them and admonishes when necessary. Okay. And that's found in 1 Thessalonians 5 through 12 through 13. And then lastly, there's one who is an example to others and leads others and with the proper attitude willingly serves. And that's found in Titus 2, 7 through 8 and 1 Peter 5, 1 through 3.
Okay. Beautiful. Beautiful.
Thank you. Excellent Beautiful. Summary.
Yeah.
Okay. We have Sister Betty.
Okay. I basically said that I didn't break it down like Diane, but I did take a lot of the information from that. I basically said that a coach is one who knows Christ for himself
mm-hmm.
and that his life reflects not only that he knows Christ, but he has a relationship with him and that he's able to teach and help develop others in that area as he developed them. He allowed the Holy Spirit to guide and direct him.
Right.
And that also was talking about in 1 Thessalonians 5:12, it talks about developing the soul. So he's teaching them and developing them in the word of God and knows the word well enough that he can divide it righteously.
Good, good.
Also, his motives should be in order to glorify God, which comes from Peter mm-hmm. 5:1-3. And that this is a stewardship and we should be serving God out of our devotion for him as we disciple others.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
No, go ahead.
And then I was just going to look at Titus because Titus talks about 2:7-8. It actually talks about some of the characteristics that we need to have. We need to be honest. We need to be serious in what we're doing. Uh-huh. We need to be with sound speech as we speak. And it also should be a speech filled with the love of God in it. Yeah. And then also we should meet people, know the person that we are coaching or discipling, meet them at the level where they are and then grow, help them to grow to where you are. And then you continue on that way.
Amen. Thank you, Sister Betty.
Yeah. That's good. That's good.
Yes, very rich.
Excellent.
Okay, Sister Gail.
Okay, all of the above? No.
Smart answer.
okay, so an effective or superlative coach. First of all, of course, they need to have a relationship with Jesus Christ, and they should be willing to share their faith and their life with the person that they're discipling. Mm-hmm. It's important, I think, to have a clear communication as to what is expected of the discipler and the disciple maker. They share the good, the bad, and the ugly. They're not only an encourager and a cheerleader, but they're also one that is ready to correct. They need to be an example, show integrity, have seriousness about the method and the manner in which they're approaching their disciple making. And one thing that really stuck out for me is that it needs to be done out of devotion, not out of duty.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, and of course, you know, integrity is one of my favorite things. So they have to show integrity so that they're not putting on a show, but they're living a life that's being shared.
Yes. Yes. Thank you so much, Sister Diane, Sister Betty, as well as Sister Gail. Amen. Very key words all of you were able to pull out, some similar and some different. So thank you so much for sharing. Amen. And I was looking down at my list to see if they did, I think you guys, I'll say ditto.
They did that. Yeah. Same thing with me. Same thing.
Yeah. I think one word that, and forgive me if I did not hear it, was being diligent. And I put in parentheses that I'm being, as a discipler coach, I'm being diligent about my own personal learning, and but also being diligent in my work with the person I'm discipling, not getting lazy. And I'm grateful that all of you mentioned the role of the Holy Spirit, because he is our enabler. Because there are definitely times, and I'll raise my hand, there are definitely times when I'm like, oh, I don't feel like it. But I recognize it's not about me, but it's about my honoring my commitment to God and my commitment to the person I'm discipling. And so being diligent and recognizing and being grateful for the fact that the Holy Spirit will guide us, give us advice and instruction, as well as the ability to do the coaching, discipling that we've been called to do. Okay, anything else, Reverend Owens?
No, that's perfect. I thought those were excellent, excellent, excellent. What I want to do is if you don't have anyone else to call upon, I want to go ahead, or if anyone has anything to share, go right ahead and raise your hand before we move to the next section. To go ahead and raise your hand, and we'll give you an opportunity to share what you might have. Renee or Beulah or Sister Bryant or, you know, any one of you that are on here, Sterling. Okay, well then what I wanna do is move forward, if you will, and I wanna just really deal with this here William Barclay section, and we'll just go as far as we can. I doubt that we'll be able to finish this particular section tonight, but I wanted to go as far as we can, and he's just so awesome in this here, how he does it. And I'll start off in the reading, if you will, and then we'll just take it and look at the summary and all of those challenges, and that ought to get us to where we need to be. According to William Barclay, our lesson tells us, according to William Barclay.
Reverend Owens, let me enter. Just could you make your screen a little bit bigger? Oh, never mind. I'm sorry, that's okay.
You sure?
I need it. No, it's fine. I needed to move. I had the gallery of people up, so I needed to move the people. So move them to the right. So you're fine, unless somebody else needs assistance. Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
All right. Then let me get it back to where it was then, so we can get there and I can see here. Where do I want it? Down one deal. Can everyone see it now? Yay or nay?
Yes.
Okay. Good. All right. Yes. Then. All right. There we go. Well, let me go here. I don't want two deals, and it did just what I didn't want it to do. I didn't want to, but we're going to just work with it tonight. Is that all right? As I'm learning this I have a new deal here where I'm able to, I downloaded the book, if you will, ebooks. And so now I'm able to do it from the book instead of scanning it like I used to, and so forth and so on. So anyway, according to William Barclay, Paul contrasts the conduct of Timothy, his loyal disciple, with the conduct of the heretics who were doing their utmost to wreck the church, that is. The word we have translated to be a disciple includes so much that is beyond translation in any single English word. It's the Greek parakaluthein, and literally means to follow alongside. When you see that para in the Greek, it always means alongside of something. Paraclete, that's the Holy Spirit who's alongside of us. Parachute, alongside of you, a paramedic. And so this is parakaluthane, and it literally means to follow alongside. But it is used with a magnificent width of meaning. It means to follow a person physically, to stick by him through thick and thin. It means to follow a person mentally, to attend diligently, that's your word, Antoinette, to attend diligently to his teaching and fully to understand the meaning of what he says. It means to follow a person spiritually, not only to understand what he says, but also to carry out his ideas and be the kind of person he wishes us to be. Parakaluthane is indeed the word for the disciple, for it includes the unwavering loyalty of the true comrade, the full understanding of the true scholar, and the complete obedience of the dedicated servant. Let me put a pen right there and get a response. Yes, sir, Brother Van.
As you read that, it made me think of 1 Samuel with Jonathan and his arm bearer.
Okay. How
he was right there with Jonathan to do anything he wanted him to do. Mm-hmm. That's what made me think when you read that portion.
Okay. Good. Okay. Anyone else?
I put a star around to follow a person physically.
Mm-hmm.
You know, stick by them through thick and thin. And right, that's there. Life to life.
Absolutely. Yes. Absolutely.
And also mentally. You know, sometimes we think that discipling is just about someone's spiritual well-being, but it's also about their physical well-being, how they're doing mentally, and of course, spiritually. I believe one of the persons who shared with us is about their summary included meeting them where they are. You know, if they're, and I'll just use this figuratively, if they're at kindergarten level, we don't approach them as if they were in, you know, graduate school working on a dissertation, but we meet them exactly where they are. Sometimes it may mean addressing some physical and maybe even material needs, because that will open the doorway for them to better understand what's happening spiritually. So yeah, it covers the total person.
Mm-hmm. And then what about it includes the unwavering loyalty?
Mm-hmm. Of a true comrade.
Yeah.
Yep. I was getting there.
Oh, okay. All righty. Okay.
And we see that he started off already by contrasting Timothy's discipleship with the discipleship of the church, because he said those disciples was wrecking the church.
Right.
Right.
Good point. Yes.
Absolutely. Yeah.
I think he points out that those heretics were in there wrecking the church. So yes. I think one of the things that we might glean from that is perhaps all of this would be easy to do if there were nothing else going on in the world. But the things that kind of attack our progress and forwardness is that there are obstacles and other difficulties that we have to go past to get beyond this. And I think perhaps... maybe we can glean that from Barclay's opening. He's saying that, you know, this guy wasn't just a good disciple. He was a good disciple in the midst of a whole lot of turmoil.
Right.
Yes.
That was there. And so he had to shake that off of him in order to stay focused on where we are. And I guess in my personal example is that when you start out to do something, it seems like there's always something else that comes up competing for your attention and your time. And so you say, if I just had a little bit more time, or if I could just put a little less to that way. So maybe, perhaps it's a focus for us, is that it won't come in a world without difficulty and trouble. That's the world we will serve others in, a world that demands our time.
Yeah. Mm.
That's
Deacon Campbell, you're answering part of my number four.
Yeah, that's an excellent response. Yes. And if we can just expand on that and say, mm-hmm. as a discipler, if you will, just be ready for your disciplee to come under extreme attack. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Because the devil doesn't want them to get this. The devil does not want them to get what you're giving them, that spiritual meat and that spiritual growth. And so they're going to come under great attack. And that means you'll be also be coming under attack.
Right.
In the process. And it's going to get frustrated sometimes, because I know that I've had arguments with people that I was discipling, and we just had around and around and around. But, you know, the Lord pulled it together for us so that we could do what he wanted done for his kingdom.
Yes, and consider the Acts 20 passage that we read, Acts 20, verse 28 and 31, or through 31, really, where it talks about the difficulties that we face within the body of Christ. Mm-hmm. So there may be people outside life happening, but also be mindful of the fact that even within the body of Christ, we have people who are attacking, people who are trying to dissuade, people who are trying to present a different gospel. So that's something we have to be mindful that our disciplees will be facing.
Absolutely. And look, if we look on the screen, you can see that a heretic is what? A person believing in or practicing religious heresy.
Heresy.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. Holding an opinion at odds with what is generally accepted.
Yep.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So we've got heretics. They come to church and they look like they know what they're talking about. They have on their Mother Day hat and they have on their Father's Day suits, you know, and look like, but sometimes they'd be way off course somewhere else.
Yes.
Amen. Okay. Anyone else?
I'm just a little concerned. You sure they would put on their Mother's Day hat? They would show up like that?
Yes, indeed.
Oh, Lord.
Father's Day suits. They're going to put on Father's Day suits. Christmas.
Oh, Lord.
Mother's Day, Easter, you know.
Yeah, they had on their Easter outfits.
Right. Okay, let me continue on if no one has anything else to say. Paul goes on. Is that where I left off, Antoinette?
Yes, that's it.
Okay, there you go. Paul goes on to list things which Timothy has been his disciple. First, there is teaching. No man can teach what he does not know, and therefore before a man can teach Christ to others, he must know him himself. I think Betty said that tonight, and I think some others said that tonight, and that's right on point. Do we need to elaborate on that? Does anyone want to say anything about that? When Carlyle's father was discussing the kind of minister his parish needed, he said, what this parish needs is a man who knows Christ other than at second hand. Mm-hmm. Real teaching is always born of real experience. There is training. The Christian life does not consist only in knowing something. It consists even more in being something. Mm-hmm. The task of the apostle is not only to tell men the truth, it is also to help them do it. The true leader gives training in living.
Amen. I know Sister Gwen is on here, so I'm just going to say the word application.
Okay.
Application. You know, we can study. We can read. We can listen. You know, we can pour through the books, we can memorize, we can meditate, but that's all wonderful. but we have to put it into practice. We have to apply the word of God. I see you've unmuted, Gwen, so go
yes,
ahead.
Amen. We have to take the print off the page, off the paper, and apply it to our lives. We have to walk that walk and talk that talk, that application. So when my disciples look at me, prayerfully, they will see the Jesus in me.
Amen.
As I walk. And so that's that application piece. I'm heavy on application.
Thank Absolutely.
Amen. Amen.
Critical. It's great that we spend time pouring through the word. We, you know, write down answers. We, you know, put scriptures on the wall, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But how are we living? How are we living? And as Sister Gwen mentioned, can people see the Christ in us, in our daily walk, in our conversation, how we think, so on and so forth. We have to apply what it says, what the word of God says. And thank you, Sister Kathy, you alluded to that when you shared about your spiritual progress.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely, absolutely. Not just talk the talk, but...
You gotta walk it, walk the walk.
Absolutely.
When I hear this and read this, I think of four things: activate, stimulate, eliminate, and emulate.
Okay. Amen. Thank you, Brother Sterling. Emulate. Is that what you said?
Yes.
End? Okay. Right. Okay. Absolutely.
Right. Great.
That's it. Great. Key factors.
Mm-hmm. The lesson that we're doing with our kids tomorrow, it kind of alludes to this a little bit, because we're talking about what a Christian is and stuff. And one of the things that it talks about is identity versus ideology. And that was the big thing that was happening when Jesus was being crucified. He wasn't being crucified for his ideology. He was being crucified because of his identity, of what he represented, who he was. He was God. And so that's the same thing that's happening to us. You know, are we really truly portraying ourselves as Christians, or are we just taking the rule book and just saying, this is what you're supposed to do?
Yeah. Yes. Man. Thank you, Sister Joanne. Man.
Yeah, that's good. That's good. Okay. And then let me get back to it again. Second, he has an aim in life. Then there is faith and patience. The word here is macrothumiai, as the Greeks used it, usually meant patience with people, not to grow irritable when they seem unteachable. Now, I just want to pause here and I want to throw this in here and say that Koine Greek is actually what you have the New Testament written in. It was written in Koine Greek. And Koine Greek is a common type of Greek. It's not like classical Greek, which was for the educated people. This is common Greek. And God knew when he was putting his plan together that the Greek language in the New Testament would be the most expressive language of any language in the world. And it would say exactly what he meant and mean exactly what he said. And so when he uses this macrothumiai, it is saying literally what he wants us to understand, and that is having patience with people, not to grow irritable when they seem unteachable. Because you're going to run into that sometimes. You're going to get stuck. Sometimes you're going to get stuck with your student for weeks at a time. Mm-hmm. But, you know, the disciplee, they just not going to grasp it. They're not going to get it. And you got to be patient with them. Right. There is love. This is God's attitude to men. Paul completes the story by speaking of the quality of endurance. The Greek is hupomone, which means not a passive sitting down and bearing things, but a triumphant facing of them, so that even out of evil there can come good. It describes not the spirit that accepts life, but the spirit that masters it.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Any responses to this? All right. Then why don't we go ahead with the summary, if you will, Sister Antoinette?
Okay. So the first question, which is number 4, what challenged you most from this study?
Okay.
And we've been in it for a minute, and we've covered several definitions, life to life. We've covered, you know, coaching. We've looked at several things that helped us to understand what it means to imitate. And most recently, we've been studying life to life, ministering life to life, one-on-one or in a group. So what's been the most challenged? What challenged you the most during this study?
I put down that it is the consistent and involvement of a lot of time, of one's time.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah.
That was my first word, consistency.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Deacon Campbell?
Wow, you called on me.
Well, I'm sorry.
Someone has written in my book, actions and action words and self-evaluation. So those were the things that challenged me in this study.
Okay. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, I saw that you were unmuted, so I thought you were ready. So thank you.
I'll fix that.
Yeah. What about Sister Eloise? Does she feel like unmuting and telling
us? I said, I'm not unmuted.
There you go. There you go.
There you are.
I would say the thing that challenged me the most from the study is the time it takes to be a discipler. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Okay. Good. Good. Very good.
Yes, it is an investment.
I just want to say one word. This is what my disciples are always telling me. Application. And she knows who that is.
Yes.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Great. Great, Sister Beulah.
You know, and Sister Beulah, one thing that I've learned about application is it may be a huge elephant, but you consume it bit bite by bite. So step by step, we're applying step by step.
Absolutely.
But being consistent.
What about Sister Renee Tucker? Does she want to unmute and weigh in?
I'm not unmuted either.
You all came
now
back.
Now you are.
Campbell's back now.
Well, I've missed a bit of this whole section, but and looking at it and looking at coaching, I've coached before in terms of helping people with develop a skill that and being patient and looking at that in terms of money and credit. So I'm just thinking about, you know, contrasting that to something like this, which is much more important, mm-hmm. And being able to make the transfer of those skills to somebody's spiritual life and just how much that takes to do that. So I'm just kind of rattling off some things that have hit me. In terms of moving it from something that matters, but not as much as really inputting where a person can spiritually grow.
Okay.
So it's a challenge. And that last sentence says, it describes not the spirit that accepts life, but the spirit that masters.
Yeah, yeah. Wasn't that awesome? That was something
that's
else.
That's very deep.
Yeah, yeah. I thought that's why I have it highlighted here.
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely.
Mm-hmm. It's very deep and it's very challenging to me. Mm-hmm. So.
Mm. Before we move on to number five, I just want to say that one of the things that I was talking to my mom about this, and one of the things that she mentioned was, and I concur, is that being able to be a living model of Jesus Christ, because we live, and I think Deacon Campbell kind of alluded to this, we live in the world, and I'll just leave it at that, where that we face all kinds of challenges. There are all sorts of things that we have to contend with, all things that we're confronted with, even if it doesn't affect us directly, we're impacted because we're watching the news, we're listening to stories and so on and so forth. And so there are times when it may not be directly us, but we hear something and our anger flares up, or we, you know, hang our head and say, no, not again. And so how do we represent Christ even in those moments? And that can be a challenge. And at the exact same time, we need to be authentic. And I often think about when I spent a significant amount of time studying the book of John, and I was really focusing on how did Jesus emote? How did he handle situations? And so I recognized there were times when he was angry, there were times when he was upset, he was despondent, he cried. And so I kept to remember that we are given those emotions for a reason, but how do we handle all of that in a way where God is still glorified? And I have to admit, there's sometimes I have to go to God and say, okay, I emoted this particular way, please forgive me. And I didn't say, and you know my heart, but I had to just say, this is how I feel at this moment. And I have to lay it at your feet so that I can recover and become the person that you desire for me to be. So yeah, there's some challenges because of where we live and how, and the conditions under which we live.
So we live in a real world. Yeah.
Absolutely. And we have to be authentic. Yeah, Sister Gwen, I think.
Oh yeah. When I look at that, what the challenges from this particular study came up with a consistency, endurance, and I'm to be vigilant, observant. I'm to observe my disciple Lee, to be attentive to my disciple Lee, and being that encourager. And what was that word, Reverend Orange? And the second, the Macahuma, what, however you pronounce that Greek word. And when I looked at that, I saw the...
Here we go. I got it for you. Just hold on. Give me one New York.
Pronounce it for me.
Oh, okay. Here it is.
Macrothumia. Right,
and it is macrothumia.
Yes. Thank you. And when I looked at that, I have to have patience with the people and not to grow irritable. And
yes.
And the main thing, especially when they seem unteachable, because sometimes I get frustrated. At times, that's one of my downfalls, dealing with frustration. But however, I always stand on Galatians 6:9, for not to grow weary in well-doing.
Absolutely.
And that's the main scripture that really keeps me going, is Galatians 6:9.
Amen. Amen. What, did I see Carrie's hand up? Did she?
Hey, she disappeared. Wait a minute.
She's shaking her head. No, you didn't.
Yes, she is.
Hand up. I was trying to draw her in to see if she needed to say something on this matter. And the reason why is because she's a counselor and she deals with people, having to help people balance this whole thing of living in the real world. And so she might have wanted to throw in her two cents and whatnot. Okay. All righty.
There she goes.
Yeah, threw two cents in. It would just to be that the frame is highly relevant for guiding people. And I definitely take this work into my work and it makes me stronger.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
Great.
Yeah. You know, as a fellow counselor, social worker, I would concur that discipling runs parallel to counseling, because that's part of what we do. And social work definitely runs parallel to being a discipler and a coach.
Very good.
Okay.
Very good.
Reverend Owens, do you think we can do the last two questions?
Let's try to hit those real quick and then press on.
Okay.
And so go on to our other business.
Okay. So number five asks, how would you describe a life-to-life ministry now?
And what does he mean now? Now that we've gone through all these.
Now that we've gone through this study.
All right.
There you go. Multiple weeks of looking at ministering life-to-life. I didn't count how many weeks we studied this. I should have marked when we started, but But how would you describe life-to-life ministry now? And that's the assumption is that you had one concept when we started the study.
Right.
And now you've arrived at the end and you have another process of thinking about life-to-life ministry.
Or have you changed your way of thinking? You know.
Oh, yeah. It might have been consistent with what we've been studying.
Right. Or have you changed it? Who wants to jump in there right quick? Has anyone been affected by this study to the point to where you've changed your way of thinking life-to-life ministry and discipleship?
When I realized I have a lot of work to do.
Yeah.
I have a lot of work to do. This is, you know, just taking a look, going over this study these past months or a few weeks, whatever, I just see what's all laid out before me and what all I need to be and become to be more diligent. So I see, I'm just going to say I have a lot of work to do, to go. I have a ways to go, but through the good Lord, I'm going to get there. I'm getting there.
Amen.
Absolutely.
So, you're partially answering number six.
Okay.
What aspect of life-to-life do you need to apply to your disciple-making ministry? And again, it's not everything, just what maybe one or two things that you can add or apply to your the process that you're already using. So anyone to just, how would you describe a life-to-life ministry now? Anyone open to responding?
I don't know. Maybe Sister Gwen needs to, maybe she's seeing that she needs to apply macrothumia.
Oh, right.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. And while I'm applying that, I'm going to rely heavily on Galatians 6:9.
That's Amen. Right. That's right. That's
yeah. right. Because in due season, you're going to see the harvest of your labor.
Yeah.
You shall reap
in due season.
I have men calling me all over the country now that I've talked to and that I've worked with and that I've discipled. And constantly calling, and we just go back over some of the things again, and we're gonna get there. We're gonna get there, you know, probably in the next lesson. I hope when we get to mentoring others, we'll get there as to what is the content that you share with them, you know, when you're discipling. It's not just, you know, something that you're just doing willy nilly, you know. No, there's some content to it. Okay.
So I feel like I keep butting in today. I don't know why, but
no, go ahead.
I put down that it is a nurturing teaching environment in which you are a spiritual coach to encourage that person to grow and develop their knowledge and skill by teaching and by example as you walk with them.
Amen.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
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 And I was just thinking there are probably people on Facebook and you, Facebook, you can definitely put your comments in, make it as a comment on our Facebook page. If you're watching via Facebook, and we can definitely go back and read and respond back in terms of words of encouragement. We don't want to just limit it to the responses to folks who are on Zoom.
That's correct. That's correct. They can also subscribe while they're there if they want to on one of our platforms, on YouTube.
On YouTube and make comments there also.
Make comments as well there. Absolutely.
Okay. Let's do one more. I know we're at 8:02, but if we could do one more and maybe get one person to respond to number six. What aspects of life-to-life do you need to apply to your disciple-making ministry? Because as we hear this response, that'll give us something that we can pray with you about. Okay, someone willing to share, what aspect of life-to-life do you need to apply to your disciple-making ministry?
Mm-hmm.
We should have everybody unmuted. Because as I'm looking at the screen, pretty much everyone on here is a discipler. And there's at least one thing we could all be doing that we can either upgrade or add to our disciple making process.
Mm-hmm.
Let me turn to the right page since I've been flipping pages.
Okay. 76.
And one of the things that I wrote down in terms of that I could add is lately, I don't want to say I've been kind of slack in terms of challenging do a wonderful job of encouraging. But a couple of times I noticed I could have challenged someone in a particular area, but I didn't say anything to them. And I just kind of let it go. And then the Holy Spirit was like, you know, you should have said something. And so not that I want it to be just on, you know, challenging, but I can do a little bit better job, because the challenge is to really help them to look at the behavior, look at what the scripture has to say, and then how do we work together to apply what the word of God says in that particular area of their life, recognizing it's a growth factor, but I really could have said something at that moment instead of letting it pass by.
Right, right.
Okay, anyone else would like to share an aspect of life to life that you need to apply to your disciple making ministry? Because it is a ministry.
Right. And maybe they might need to absorb it and think on it.
Yeah.
And maybe that'll be where we pick up on next week when we come
back
and then go into mentoring others. And we, this time I won't do all the reading, but we're going to just have others, because I think we can clear it if we just let everybody else jump in and read for us. Mentoring Others by Larry Glaib, or is it Glaib? I don't know him in particular, on page 76 of your book. And then we'll just pick it up and run with it from there. Do we have any comments or any statements that anyone needs to make before we disengage? Okay. Well, we want to thank you for joining us tonight. Those of you who are on our platforms, thank you so much for being with us on our Teaching Tuesdays. And you can participate if you'd like to by giving. Of course, there are several ways that you can give to the Cornerstone Missionary Baptist Church of Oakland, California. Our address is 3535 38th Avenue, Oakland, California. One way you can give is simply by just coming. You can mail a check or a money order here to the church proper, and we'll receive it, or you can put it in the mail slot, or you can ring the doorbell and we'll receive it that way as well. And then you can just simply give us a call and we'll come pick it up. And then, of course, I like to use Zelle. And do you have that, Sister Curry, that you can put up there for them to see our Zelle address, if you will? I like to use Zelle. And when I do that, when I use Zelle, it doesn't cost me anything. It does not cost the church anything at all. And I just simply go to my app, like I'm doing now, my Wells Fargo app, if you will. And when I go to that app and I look at and I press send money, and then it just pops up and I see Zelle. And then, of course, on Zelle, it says the recipient, and I go and I do cstonecan.finance@gmail.com. And it immediately goes from my and to the church's account. And therefore, you know, we're all happy. Everybody's good about that. And then for those who still like Givelify, you can go right ahead with Givelify through our church website. And we just ask that you'll add a little extra for that surcharge, for that little tax they give, that 3% surcharge or tax that they charge us for and whatnot. And then, of course, our pastor, he is not on salary, but we certainly want to be a blessing to him, because he has absolutely been a blessing and is a blessing to us right now today. And then we want to close out praying for him as well, Brother Campbell, if you will, as we get ready to disengage, from our friends who are on YouTube and Facebook. Thank you so much, Deacon Campbell. If you can unmute, Brother Campbell. You're not unmuted yet, but if you can...
We had a recalcitrant mouse for a minute. And Sister Trotter, if you would remain with us for a minute. So let's bow in a word of prayer.
Mm-hmm.
Father, we thank you once again that you allow us the privilege of prayer. It's a great privilege. It allows the such as us to come before the Most High God, he that has all power, he that has all knowledge, and he, as this lesson says, it has all the love for us. It allows us to come as we are, with having committed some actions and omitted some actions, which resulted in what you call sin. And we come agreeing with you that that's what it was. And we lay that at your feet with contrition, and you are faithful every time we do that to forgive it. It restores us to a fellowship. It brings us back to a proper position of being an heir with you. And therefore, there's nothing that separates us from your love and from your power and from your privilege. And Father, with all of that, you allow us to collectively pray for each other. And it says that you indwell those prayers, that we can call out the names of other people. We can bring you the concerns of other individuals. And you hear those amplified through our prayers. And we thank you for it. Father, we take the privilege right now and we pray for our pastor. We thank you in a mighty way for him. We thank you for the fellowship that we've had with him. We thank you for the professorship, the teaching that he's provided us across the years. What we know, we've learned from him. Mm-hmm. Lord, the preacher said on Sunday, what I know about the Bible, I learned in Sunday school right here at Cornerstone.
Amen.
We thank you for that ministry. We thank you for the fruitfulness of that ministry. Over 30 pastors, over 30 preachers, many pastors, an international ministry. And we're just thankful for that. And Father, we know that this week he's indicated to us that he's going through some things. He's described them as some procedures that require some close look and that he may be under the guidance of medical professionals. Mm-hmm. Lord, we ask that they would be efficacious and that they would be patient and that they would be kind and they would regard him as we regard him. Then, Father, we thank you for this program this evening, a manifestation of that ministry. We've gotten together here, not to watch the Warriors that are about to play in, but to study your word among each other and to enjoy it. And we're thankful for that, Father.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you.
And then, Lord, we want to, that word was application. We want to use this. My word was I need self-evaluation. We want to do more than just hear this. We want to use this. We want to make a difference with it. And we want to do that because we're thankful for what you've given us.
Yeah.
It's in the mighty name of Jesus that we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Thank you for joining us. You all have a good blessed week or evening. And we'll see you again tomorrow night for Bible study. Thank you, Sister Carrie, for taking Sister Curry.